بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله على احسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشانه واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي الى رضوانه. My dear brothers, السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. As you all know, we started discussing the Aqeedah Wasitiyyah. The Imam رحمه الله تعالى ابن تيميه started by describing the manhaj or the decree of Ahl Sunnah and Jama'ah in the beginning, and then he put the rules or the meaning of Tawheed, Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah, and then Tawheed Asma' al-Sifat, the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After he finished these rules or foundations or whatever you want to call them, he started using the Book of Allah to support his arguments in the way we understand the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He started with the chapter of Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, that has the Tawheed in it. Then he started second, he started by the verse of Al-Kursi that we described or explained last week. The Ayatul Kursi, as it's we mentioned last time, it's very important that you understand it and you recite it every day. Now, he continues actually, as I said last time, maybe 100 verses from the Quran. These verses that he brings in, most of them in the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He tried to emphasize how do we understand the names of Allah and the attributes. Why? Because the people get deviated by this. And we mentioned some of these groups, like the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila are groups who are a follower of a certain way of understanding the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Sunnah. They made their brains, their minds, ahead of the script, ahead of the Quran and the Sunnah. And they understand whatever they comprehend, they will comprehend. If they don't comprehend it, they will not accept it. So they, in a way, refused all the names of Allah and refused the attributes of Allah, which is very to us it's very annoying, because how do you understand this? And because it's all mentioned in the Book of Allah, you have the names of Allah and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then somebody comes and say we don't believe in them, we should not do that. Their argument is that when you call Allah by different names, that we are making association. And that's a very important concept here, that when we describe Allah by different names, or calling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by different names or different attributes, we're not dividing or naming too many gods or lords. No. It's only one, but we have many attributes for him. The way he actually described himself in the Book of Allah, by his own words. This is the way he described himself. And today we will come to, the Sheikh says, maybe today we'll finish maybe 6 or 7 verses explaining, and all of them in the attributes and the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse says, هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. He is the first and the last, the ascendant and the intimate, and he all knows everything. Okay, that's the closest in translation to the verse. Now, what is awwal? What is the first for us? Can we explain to ourselves? As Muslims, we will accept what the Prophet ﷺ explained it. When the Prophet ﷺ explained this, explained the Quran, then we'll have to accept it, right? Can you say no, the understanding is not right? So the Prophet said Al-Awwal, or the first, is the one there is no before him. Nothing before him. لَيْسَ شَيْءٌ قَبْلَهُ. And Al-Akhir, nothing is after him. Okay? And Al-Batin is what? Do you know what Al-Awwal, Al-Akhir, Al-Zahir, Al-Batin? Al-Zahir first. Al-Zahir is the Ulu, the highest. Just like saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لِيَظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. The religion of Allah, Islam, should be prevailing conquer other religions. And we are seeing this even though we are a weak ummah. Al-Batin is the closest. In a way, it's called, I mean, they translate it intimate. I don't know, I mean, if this is very close. So, he's maybe the closest, the qareeb. يدنو مننا or very close. In a way, this is the understanding of Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah. This is the way we understand these names. But you have to remember now, these names, when you call Allah al-Awwal, you also call Allah al-Akhir. Some of the scholars, you do not call Allah al-Awwal first by itself. They say you should call him also, he is the Akhir. Look at these names, actually. They are like periodically, or it's in the time, the first and the second, or the last, kind of numbering sequence. So you cannot say, call Allah al-Awwal alone. You should call him also, he's al-Awwal, and he's also al-Akhir. He's the first and the last. The same thing here, al-Zahir, the top, and he's the closest, or al-Batin. Okay, so they are together, these names. We call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by these names together. So this is what we learn from this verse. Even though we have different names, but they are also the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is one, but he has different names. Just we know that from the hadith, the names of Allah are 99. Whoever, you know, memorize them and say them and things like that, act upon them, will be rewarded to Jannah. The same thing are these. We are talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is one, but He has so many names. And this is what we are talking about here. That's why some people get deviated by these things, but just sometimes does not make sense. But when bid'ah comes, it spreads. When bid'ah comes, it spreads. We cannot say more than that. So there is ليس وهو الباطن ليس دونه شيء or I mean I would call it دون mean in Arabic has actually two meanings. It's closest or under or under, you know, something like that. But it doesn't make sense to say under. Maybe the word intimate is more close to understanding. Dunu is in Arabic is the one which is very close. Okay. So this is the first verse, and actually this. In the some of the actually supplications and du'a of Prophet ﷺ, he used to use this. هو الأول والذا أنت الأول فليس قبلك شيء وأنت الآخر فليس بعدك شيء وأنت الظاهر وأنت الباطن. أغنينا من الفقر. What the actually the subhanAllah, I forgot the du'a. أغنينا من الفقر. I mean, protect us from being poor. This is actually part of the du'a of the Prophet ﷺ. So, these, you know, when you make dua, you also use the names of Allah and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You supplicate to Him by His names. You supplicate to Him by His attributes. Okay? So, the second verse that the Shaykh brought in, he said, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. Okay? Now, but from the first one, we learned that Allah has the name al-awwal and al-akhir. Name also. He's al-Zahir and he's also al-Batin. We know these things. And these names are, as I said before, they come together. You cannot separate them. Okay? Now, the Shaykh now bring together another verse which he says, قوله تعالى, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. توكل, what does it mean? Trust or depend on, يعني, this word actually tawakkal is from the Arabic word we say wakala. Okay, means you give somebody authorization to represent you or something like that. But this is acceptable. But when it comes, if it's a tawakkul of ibadah, like you make tawakkul to somebody to help you, to save you in the hereafter, or give you good things and bad things and so forth. This kind of shirk, you have to be very careful. Tawakkul is a ibadah actually. Because it means you rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And that's what the verse is. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. Make tawakkul rely on the one who does not die. Remember, we said last time, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum, ever living. Alladhi la yamut, ever living. He does not die. We die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not die. So we cannot accept the argument that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala died. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever living. Hayy. Alladhi la yamut. So this is the second verse that he mentioned. Maybe I will maybe read the translation. And rely upon the ever living who does not die, and exalt Allah with his praise, and sufficient is he to be with the sins of his servants acquainted. That Allah knows everything. That's the translation of the verse. Now, the Shaykh also now, the third, is it okay with the explanation? You know, just like, يعني وتوكى على الحي الذي لا يموت. Now, in this verse, what are the names of Allah here? Al-Hayy. The one who is Hayy, what is the attribute? Hayah, he is living. You see? Now, Allah is the Ali. This is his name. His ilm is his what? His attribute. Okay? His knowledge, his attribute. He knows everything, what was before and what's gonna come after. Okay? So we're trying to connect now, because now sometimes you find in the Quran and the Sunnah only names and also only attributes only. And sometimes you will have a name that has its own attribute in it. It's part of it. It's the meaning of the name is attribute also. Like when you say ever living, Hayy. The Hayya or living is his attribute. He's always living. See what I'm saying? But we call him Al-Hayy. Okay. The other verse, or the third verse, the Shaykh says, وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Allah has already ordained for you Muslims the dissolution of your oath, and Allah is your protector, and He is the knowing and the wise. Now He is the wise and the knowing. Knowing, we, if you actually, in these 6-7 verses I brought in today, most of them talk about Allah is all knowing. And this is the attribute and the name that Alim, that the verses talk about. If you notice, many of them has the Alim in it. Many. وهو العليم الحكيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the wise. Because you have to think of Allah as the wise. The wise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His qadr, by His qada. You know, there is what we call sunan al-kawniyya, or the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His ruling, al-hukm. Hukm is like ruling in this world. Okay? So al-hakim is the one who is the wise, who makes the good judgment. So there are sunan shar'iyya and sunan kawniyya. Means that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows an earthquake to happen, this is something when people make bad things in this world. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي كسب الذي فعل عمل sorry. Then Allah says that corruption happens in this world, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them based on what they have committed. When people commit a lot of sins, Allah will punish them. That's a rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a universal rule. When bad things happen in this world, Allah will punish the people. So, hukm shar'i or hukma shar'iyya means Allah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to do our prayers, our hajj, these are ahkam shar'iyya that we have to follow. Hukm. And that's why we assume or we believe as Muslims that all these rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed on us are wise. That's why we call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the wise, the hakeem. You cannot think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala differently. He's Hakim, but he does not have wisdom. Yani when you go to other groups like Jahmiyyah or Mu'tazila, we cannot call Allah Al-Hakim. How come? He calls himself Al-Hakim. That's why we're emphasizing these names and attributes. The whole Aqeedah Wasatiyyah actually talks about this important concept. It is very important to mention that in our time, few people actually take these things or talk about them. But sometimes people, I feel they are deviated in the Qadr issue that we discussed early on. You find them do not accept Islam as a ruling constitution or Islam to be the hakam or the way of life. They don't accept it. They want to be Muslims. They might even want to pray. But when it comes to other things, they don't want to implement Islam. And that's what we know as a political issue around us. The world is suffering because a lot of people fight Islam because they are afraid of it. They don't want Islam to be implemented. So this is also another issue that a Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. They want to be a good believer unless they make you the ruler or the command. They follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in our time, you might don't find these things coming to, unless you argue with a Shia or somebody who's maybe what we call the Mu'tazila in our time, or maybe what we call the Asraniyin, meaning they always use their heads ahead of the Quran and Sunnah. Anything do not comprehend from the Book of Allah or the Sunnah, they reject it. These are really the same thing. They are very close to what we are talking about here. Because we take the Quran as is. We understand it the way the Prophet ﷺ understood it. He taught it to his companions. That's something we have to follow. Now, the other verse, or the fourth verse, the Shaykh quoted, Allah says, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلْجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا وَمَا يَنْزُلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا. He subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what penetrates the earth and what emerges from it and what descends from the heaven and what ascends therein. Okay. What penetrates the ground, what comes of it, you can, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now we're talking about the knowledge. Allah alim, ya'lam. He knows what comes from the ground. You can imagine what comes from the ground or the earth. Now in our time we have gas, we have oil, we have that. Yani if you think about it centuries ago, it's not something imaginable that oil will come from the ground maybe 2,000 meters down and we bring oil and we drive cars. It's not imaginable. But we as Muslims believe Allah knows that the people will do this. Even Allah knows what will be planted, what will be planted, what kind of seeds will come and so forth. What will go in and what will go out. You see, Allah is talking to us. He knows, he says, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلْجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا. Allah says that. He knows what goes in and what comes out. And what goes to the skies and what comes down from the heaven. Do we know? We don't know. Can you, you might see something small, but you don't know what's going to happen in other places. But the ilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a very important concept to have in your mind, the knowledge of Allah is encompasses everything. What we say in Arabic, actually a word which is called muhit. Muhit is surrounding everything. His knowledge, his ilm. Okay? So this is the meaning of this. Now, in this verse, what we have is the ilm. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَرْجُ. So, and we have implication, implied actually in this, is the ahata, which is the encompasses everything. His ilm is encompassing everything. This is what the verse says. If anybody assumes that is not possible, وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, he's committing kufr. Because he's rejecting what Allah says about himself. Can you think of Allah does not do this or doesn't know things, these things? It's not imaginable. Because he's committing a great sin and he's calling Allah or naming Allah by or attributes that does not exist. That it will be the opposite. It's like shirk. And we as Muslims, you're rejecting anything from the Quran is committing wal'iyadu billah kufr. You're refusing anything from the book of Allah. Okay. Now we come to another important same thing. It's all about knowledge and ilm. This ayah says, وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُوَ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَا تَسْقُطُ مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ إِلَّا يَعْلَمُهَا وَلَا حَبَّةٍ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا رَاطِبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. The close translation, and with him are the keys of unseen. None knows them except him, and he knows what is on the land and in the sea. Not a leaf falls, but that he knows it, and no grain is there within the darkness of the earth, and no moist or dry thing, but that it written in a clear record. And this verse, subhanAllah, is very important. Allah is telling you that he knows everything what happens in this, even when a leaf drops from a tree. If you lived in a country where a lot of trees, when the fall comes, you walk just like walking in the carpet, you walk on the leaves. The leaves in the in the fall time, the autumn time, if you go to England, some of these countries that a lot of trees and a lot of green, at the fall time, like September, October time frame, the leaves of the trees, just like you are walking on a carpet. So much. Allah knows all of these things. Allah knows each seed when it comes up or not. And that's what he says in the Quran. And we believe in the Quran. And Allah described himself by this, that he knows all these things. Now, in the hadith of Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ said, the keys of unseen are five. The keys of the unseen are five. إن الله عنده علم الساعة ويعلم ما في الأرحام إن الله عنده علم الساعة وينزل الغيث ويعلم ما في الأرحام وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت إن الله عليم خبير. Allah knows these five things that does not give it to people to know. إن الله عنده علم الساعة. The day of judgment, none of us know what in the day of judgment. Even the Prophet ﷺ. When Jibreel asked the Prophet ﷺ, what time the resurrection, the sa'a comes, said, I don't know. He answered in Arabic, means in a way that you are asking me that I don't know. I don't know. That's what it means. Allah knows. In the Quran, يسألونك عن الساعة أيان مرساها. Allah knows. So Allah kept this for himself when the day of judgment will come. But the Prophet in Ahadith and even in the Quran, Allah gave us some signs and marks that will make you think about it. And he gave us some signs when the corruption happens, when the zina happens, when the alcohol and bad things and killing. These are signs of what? Signs of the day of judgment is getting closer and closer. So, and then in the hadith says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ. Now, al-ghayth we don't know, which just means the rain when it comes. Who knows the rain might come tomorrow or no? Even the people who have satellites, they say it's possible. But who knows when next year it will rain or not? They don't know, Allah knows. 2, 3 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks down the road, Allah knows, they don't know. Even though they have technology and they have monitoring things, that's what you think of. It's not make it like tomorrow. Tomorrow, they can put the satellites and see the pictures. If there's some clouds are coming, they will give you a chance or not because of their readings. They see it after the fact. But Allah knows it will happen or will not happen. After a week, 2 weeks, 1 month down the road, Allah knows. Okay. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ. The arham is in the woman, you know, if they're pregnant or not. Now, we're not talking about women, يعني, our sisters. We're talking about any female from all kind of creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means. Some people just look at it, you know, he's a boy or a girl, things like, no, don't make it so small. The ayah is very general. Allah knows what's in the womb. Of course, in our time, they have technology, they can see, oh, this is a boy or a girl. Yeah, they, or the woman is pregnant or not. They are signs, they have some technology, they understand things. But they do it after the fact. But who knows, a woman will be pregnant next week. They don't know. Allah knows. Okay? That's the issue that you need to remember. So there is no questioning in these things. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا. You don't know how much, if you're going to succeed in your trade or your commerce, or you're going to be fired from your job, or you, nobody knows. You are doing your work, Allah knows what's your risk. Allah knows. And the other one is none of us know where he will die. Nobody. You might live in this country for 50 years. Last day you leave to another country, you die there. Allah knows. And we are maybe mature enough to know so many stories. Some people come to work one day, the first day they die. Allah's hikmah there. Allah knows. But these are what we call, the Prophet ﷺ called them, the keys of the unseen. The Fatih al-Ghayb. In the hadith, actually, it's also a verse in the Quran. A verse in the Quran. Now, he says also, the verse, notice again, that most of these verses talk about ilm of Allah. That Allah's ilm encompasses everything. Because you talk about ya'lam this and ya'lam all these seeds and all these female, pregnant, not pregnant. Allah knows. It's all about knowing. And now if somebody comes and tells you Allah, you cannot call him al-alim. No, you cannot. You cannot accept this argument. There were some groups refused this before. That's why we are teaching this. And it's part of our tawheed. It's not just a matter, it's a simple matter. No. You cannot worship somebody you think differently than what he wants you to think of him. Allah tells you he's alim, then you think of him as alim. Okay? Again, he uses another ayah or verse in chapter Fatir. وَمَا تَحْمِلُ مِنْ أُنْثَى وَلَا تَضَعُ إِلَّا بِعِلْمِهِ. There is no female get pregnant or يعني, conceive or whatever without his knowledge. It has the same meaning that we mentioned before. But this is just another verse that he, the Shaykh, Jazallah Khair, using the same argument that Allah's knowledge is there and he knows what will happen. And we cannot call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know or anything like that. Another verse he says, Al-Alimu Al-Khabir. Now we have now Al-Alimu. Al-Alimu, we know what Al-Alim means. Okay? Because we talked about it many times now. Al-Khabir, another name. What Khabir, you know, means to you? The expert. Okay? The attribute of expert, the name of the expert, Khabir. The name of expert is someone who has experience, something, he has knowledge about something. So it has implication or meaning of alim as well. Your experience. So Allah called himself Al-Khabir. He knows the ins and outs of things. Okay? So you cannot call Allah doesn't know. And he doesn't know what's going on. Because he called himself the Khabir. Al-Alim Al-Khabir, when it comes to issues of argument and talking behind or things like that, if you read the Quran, in many verses that has to do, he uses sometimes Al-Khabir. And these names actually are attributes when you think about them, why Allah used Al-Alim Al-Khabir, why he used Al-Aziz Al-Hakim. If you read the verse, You know, I'll give you a story that a Bedouin, the Imam was reciting in the Salah, والسارق والسارق والسارقة فقطعوا أيديهما جزاء أن كان بما سبحان الله رحمة الله والسارق والسارقة والسارق والسارق فقطعوا أيديهما جزاء بما كسب أن كان من الله والله عزيز الحكيم means the thief or the woman who the thief in general cut his hand as a punishment and the Imam said والله غفور رحيم والله he said والله غفور رحيم doesn't make sense because you are calling for the punishment of this thief to cut his hand and now you're saying in the end of the verse Allah is forgiving no the right thing to say what Allah says in the Quran والله عزيز حكيم عزيز مط he's the one who has the power the mighty that he can do things and force things to happen and Hakim is also wise that makes sense together in Arabic language but when you say Ghafur Rahim and you punish it doesn't make sense so when somebody heard it and the Arabs were they are very smart in understanding the language now we are very weak unfortunately but before the Arabs would understand these things by heart and they will answer So I mean, the brother is looking at me. I don't know if we are. Shall we stop or what? Anyway, I will maybe we'll stop at this verse, which is in the same context. قوله تعالى لتعلموا أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. It is Allah who has created seven heavens and of the earth, the like of them. His command descends among them so you may know that Allah is over all things competent and that Allah has encompassed all things in knowledge. The same meanings we've been talking about. Allah knows not just what happens in the earth. Remember, we Ahl Sunnah say Allah says in the Quran that there is seven heavens and seven earths. Maybe there are another generations or any creatures living, another human beings, we don't know. But we believe that's what came in the Ahadith and came in the Quran. We don't know, but we know there are seven heavens. And Allah knows what happens in all this universe. Remember last time we said Al-Kursi, is the place of the foots of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the kursi to the throne, to the arsh, is just like a ring you throw it in the desert. Let's give you how big is the throne is. And how big is actually the kursi is also. The kursi compared to the heavens, or the heavens, sorry, compared to the kursi of Allah, just like a ring, you throw it in the desert. And vice versa, the kursi to the arsh, to the throne of Allah, just like a ring, you throw it in the desert. The size. You can imagine when we say Allahu Akbar. You can say Allahu Akbar because Allah is bigger than anything you can imagine. And we are a very small creature and we sometimes, wal-iyadu billah, challenge Allah in many things. May Allah forgive us all and give us guidance. Maybe I'll stop here because I think it's time. So if we allow maybe 5-10 minutes for small discussion. If you have any question, we'll inshallah discuss it. Inshallah, jazakumullah khair.